Daddacool Show. Daddacool Show. Daddacool Show. Daddacool Show. It's the Daddacool Show.
And welcome to episode 4 of the Daddacool Show. You're still with us, which is good. This week we have the Meningitis Special. The other week I went to a bloggers forum on meningitis up in Birmingham. It was a long way to travel for a forum on meningitis, but the subject was worthy of the distance. Setting forth at 6 a.m, we arrived just in time for the pastries and hot tea before the thing started. Marvellous. All three major UK meningitis charities were represented at this forum. Meningitis UK, the Meningitis Trust, and Meningitis Research. As well as all these charities, we were given a long and informative talk by Dr. Rob. You can tell how well researched and thought out and scientific it was by his use of PowerPoint. Seldom have I seen a PowerPoint display with more PowerPoint slides or more embedded videos. We learnt many things specifically about the meningitis bacterial infection, the virus and the fungal infection. We learnt that the bacterial meningitis, meningococcal, is the most deadly, and if left untreated, it's fatal in 90% of cases. We also learnt that most GPs, and there's over 40,000 of them in the country, may only see 2 cases of meningitis in their career. This makes it very difficult for doctors to diagnose meningitis because they just don't see it. We all came away with a strong belief that parents must act as their child's advocate. If parents are educated in the symptoms of meningitis, nobody knows their child better than they do, and they're best placed to make an early diagnosis, which may be saving the child's life or at least minimalising the effects that meningitis can have. We also learned how vaccines work, which was very informative for me. Take this egg. Imagine this egg is a Kinder Surprise. A vaccine works by mimicking the outer chocolatey shell on the pretend Kinder Surprise, but actually taking out the virus that's in the middle. So the virus is gone, but your body's immune system, when injected with the vaccine, recognises the virus by the chocolatey surround that's been duplicated and creates the antibodies to kill the virus, or what it thinks is the virus. Of course, it works better as a demonstration with a chocolate egg, but I hate the chocolate egg. I have to admit, understanding this about the makeup of vaccines has really changed my view on them. I always thought we were being injected with a little bit weakened down version of the actual virus to build up immunity. But now that I know it's just the outer shell of the virus without the actual nasty bit of the virus in it that's been sort of turned into a vaccine, I feel a lot happier about giving my children the vaccines in general. Another of the things they told us in the meningitis workshop was if you wait for the rash, can often be too late, and the rash isn't present in every case of meningitis anyway, because it's not really meningitis, it's septicemia or blood poisoning. There are other things to look for which are identifiable a lot earlier on, which can give your child a much better chance of survival. These include having a fever but cold hands and feet, which is quite unusual, being floppy or sort of lifeless, refusing food. And this is where being your child's sort of advocate comes in, because you know your child. If your child normally stuffs their chops with food all the time but suddenly stops eating and has a couple of other symptoms, that's a sign that a doctor might not pick up. But there are others as well, and I've linked, if you look below, you can see a link to the Meningitis Trust card on the subject, which is invaluable. I'd download it if I was you, okay? Now, before I hand you over to Sue Davis, Chief Executive of the Meningitis Trust, to say a few words about her charity and the work that they do, I just want to leave you with this thought. In your role as your child's advocate, isn't it worth pressing for a second opinion if you're not satisfied? Isn't it worth asking, are you sure? Have you seen a case of meningitis before? To your GP, whoever it may be. Carry one of the cards around. Know your child. Be your child's advocate. Because at the end of the day, you know best. And if a doctor only sees two cases of meningitis in his career, do you want your child to be the third one that he misses? Now it's over to Sue.
Hi, I'm Sue Davie. I'm Chief Executive at the Meningitis Trust. We're the oldest and largest meningitis charity in the world, and what we're focused on is supporting people affected by the disease. The challenge with meningitis is about knowing the signs and symptoms and making sure that people very quickly identify that their child needs help, because by doing that you can both save their lives, or if they actually survive you can make sure that they don't have after effects. So we want to really encourage everybody at the Meningitis Trust to make sure that people know about the signs and symptoms, and you can get access to that from anywhere, like our website at meningitis-trust.org. You can download apps for smartphones from meningitisapp.co.uk, or you can phone our free phone helpline on 0800 028 1828 and get a symptoms card to carry. So any way you can get hold of that information, just hold on to it, because it could help to save a life.